Respected Shri Krishnabhai Patel, Dr. Vasani, Governing Council members, faculty members, distinguished guests, and my dear students. It is indeed a pleasure to be here with you today on this special occasion. Convocation is always a special occasion for the students. And this comes once in a lifetime of the students. And I think the way in which it is organized today, I really compliment the Nirma University, their management, and all the students. It was precision where everybody has followed the rules prescribed and everything was done on the dot. I only wish that we do the same thing while we are on the road, either for the traffic or for any other things, so that the self-discipline which we create among ourselves, you know, becomes very important in the long-term life of every individual. This is a very memorable day for all of you, and it's a proud day in our lives. As from here, it will be beginning of a new chapter, a new era. Friends, at the outset, please accept my heartiest congratulations as you complete yet another milestone in your academic career, as you prepare to embark on a new journey. When I was having the photograph session and I saw some of the students, there's a shining spark I can see within each one of you. It is this spark that makes you feel truly alive and special. Nurture this spark and it will keep you going. Only thing I would like to advise all the students that now you are going into unfamiliar terrain. Greet this new world with the open arm. Grab every opportunity that you can get. As you step into a new career, it is helpful to understand that life will not start with a big bang or a bed of roses. You have to work each day, or rather earn each day, and make it worthwhile for you and broader society. Move step by step towards building it. Remember, there isn't any shortcut to success. Enjoy your success, but also embrace your failures. Friends, learning never stops. It is a continuous process. It is the learning from all your failures that will help you achieve your goals. So don't just stop here. You need to get better from your current level. I urge all of you to continue seeking new ways of enhancing your knowledge and garnering new skills. Today I was in a flight, afternoon coming from Mumbai, and I saw the Economic Times in the flight. And that article said, "Thank God I failed." So very amused to read the article. And it talks about the people who are very important in the world. Therefore, you should not worry about the failure. Because if you fail somewhere, you will succeed somewhere else. In this article, Henry Ford, Bill Gates, Walt Disney, Soichiro Honda, Akio Morita, they have all been there, and we are not talking about their much celebrated successes. Rather, these features is about what hit them before they became rich and famous. Gates gave up on Harvard. Disney and Ford stumbled into bankruptcy. Honda failed a job interview at Toyota. I think that's why the Honda came into picture. And Sony founder Morita, first product, an electric rice cooker, had a few takers. Therefore, you will see in your life that there are no bed of roses. You have to work very hard. And in this working, you will come across lot of adversity. Create this adversity into opportunity. Because every adversity also has a solution. And that is where your skill, your training, your innovation, all this will work. You have got to dream. Dream to become bigger and better. Nobel Prize winner Anatole France once said, "To accomplish great things, we must not only act, but also dream. Not only plan, but also believe. Believe in yourself. You are no inferior to anybody else. And therefore, if you believe in yourself, plan accordingly, and dream, you will be successful." To give an example, somebody in United States of America, in a small meeting of maybe 8, 10, 20 people, said, "Why men can't go to the moon?" Now somebody could have said, "Nonsense, forget it, don't waste your time, etc., etc." Nothing would have happened. But other people encouraged him. He said, "It's a good thought, how do we do it?" And that's how the whole planning started. And the men went to the moon. Therefore, no idea is a bad idea. Any idea which you can create, think about it, plan about it, dream about it. When you dream about an idea, I think it becomes, over a period of time, a successful idea. Dhirubhai Ambani also dreamed, and he created a very big empire. I think we must learn how to dream. But in a business scenario, the dream is typically called the vision, and it defines the final destination of your business. Therefore, wherever you are, you know, your dream should get converted into vision, and that vision, you must work towards implementing it. Another tips I want to give you is that move ahead fearlessly. Don't just worry. Fear is an illusion which exists just in our minds and not in the real sense. Move ahead fearlessly. Don't fear falling down or making mistakes. Your mistakes are your own imprint of getting to where you need to be. The story is never over. Actually, there is a story that a very rich woman, she wanted to do her house. And she calls all the architect and interior designer. And she is very rich. So everybody came. They gave their plan. And then she asked a question, one by one, to everybody, individually. That, "Have you ever made a mistake in doing up a house?" Everybody said, "No, how can we make a mistake? When we plan, we do this, we never make a mistake." One young architect said, "Yes, madam, I have made a mistake in the past, but I don't repeat my mistake." And he got the contract. The point here is this, that every human being makes a mistake, but when you don't repeat your mistake, you know, that's the lesson. And that is where the challenge lies. You can make a mistake once, but make sure that you don't repeat it. All these mistakes are not mistakes, but they are only lessons. To go forward in your life, you must create a core values. And these core values are very important for every human being. What are the values? You know, they become a strong foundation and also a method for living your life to its fullest. And in this foundation you need importance of trust, innovation and integrity. Trust is very, very important, because do you trust your family? Do you trust your father? Do you trust your wife? Do you trust your colleague in the organization? Do you trust your customer? I think that trust should be built when you are working in your, either in your business or in your personal life. I think that's a core value, and I think trust is extremely important in developing any human being. Innovation is an energy, because if you, you know, think about like this, just as energy is the basis of life itself, the ideas the source of innovation. So is innovation the vital spark of all human change, improvement and progress? You must think about how do you do better than others, and that can only happen through innovation. And whenever any business in the world over, if you see, like for example Apple, I mean, they innovated product after product, and because of that today, you know, they are number one company in the world. Look at what has happened to a small company which has started in a garage called Google, and where are they today? Facebook, I think all of the Middle East revolution of democracy is because of the Facebook. So I think these are the new innovation which are created, you know, and that really creates a newer ideas, a better business. And therefore think about innovating whenever you are working, wherever you are working, that how do you innovate and how can you do better than others. The integrity, I think, is the most important thing. It is not to satisfy some other human being. This integrity is to satisfy yourself. It is doing the right thing even if nobody is watching. I think that's very important. You must try and see that do you have a guilty conscience. So integrity is extremely important, you know, in everybody's life. Now what happens in a life cycle? In a life cycle of people, there are cycles. Cycles are everywhere. Cycles are for individuals, cycles are there for corporate, and cycles are there for nations. You must have seen in a lifetime of people, sometimes they do very well, sometimes they do bad. People say it must be panoti, something must happen, Sunni Maharaj ki krupa nahi hai. All those kind of things also happen in the life of individuals. If you look at the corporates, the corporate which has not moved forward, has not innovated, have gone down, and you know, they are no more there. If you look at some of the corporate of 60s and 70s, you know, they may not be there, and a newer corporate starts coming in. And this is the cycle of life, and this dominates the life of individual, corporation, and even the nations. I would like to little bit talk about one cycle, you know, where you know, the nations are changing and what happens to the different nations. We all know the change of season to the best of human heart to the economic boom are the slowdown, recession, recovery, and then boom again, and this pattern continues for the life. Now this cycle which I am going to talk about is a cycle of India. What happened to India? If you really go back about 1500 years to 2000 years back, what was India? In the first AD, India's economy had a 32.9% share of the world income, the largest in the world. We had the largest income in the world in India. 1000 AD, India's economy had a 28.9% share of the world income, again the largest in the world. 1500 AD, India's economy had 24.5% share, and we are the second largest. China was the largest with 25%. In effect, India and China were dominating and having 50% of the world income. In 1600 AD, at the time of Akbar, the income of India in Mughal Empire was bigger than the Great Britain's total treasury. In 1700, in Aurangzeb time, we had 24.4% share of world income, again largest in the world. As late as 1820, India's economy had a 16% share of the world income, the second largest in the world after Japan. What happened to us? During the British Raj in 1868, India's economy had a 12.2% share of the world income, which went down in 1913 to 7.6% share of the world income. And when British left, we are at 1 to 2% of the world GDP. We as a country actually lost a lot in the British time. Sometimes I wonder, how could such a powerful country fall to a small country like Britain? I'll share with you something which actually will answer that question. Lord Macaulay was a senior strategist with East India Company, and he was sent to India to study India and get back with a strategy note that would help British to conquer India. Lord Macaulay, in his speech of February 2, 1835 in British Parliament, now I quote, he gave a speech, I am quoting his speech. I have traveled across the length and breadth of India, and I have not seen one person who is a beggar, who is a thief. Such a wealth I have seen in this country, such high moral values, people of such caliber, that I do not think we would ever conquer this country. Unless we break the very backbone of this nation, which is her spiritual and cultural heritage. And therefore, I propose that we replace her old and ancient education system, her culture, for if the Indian think that all that is foreign and English is good and greater than their own, they will lose their self-esteem, their native self-culture, and they will become what we want them, a truly dominated nation. It was only in early 1900 when Mahatma Gandhi, an Indian, senior Indian politician, realized and they reversed the strategy stated to happen. They boycotted the British goods. That India started to walk towards freedom and finally got it. It took us a long period of time. And therefore, the point I am making here is this, that we had a great country, then we went down, but now our time is coming. And our time is coming because the cycles always change. What goes up has got to go down. In my personal belief, the US and Europe has got to go down. They have no choice. The nature takes its own course and cycle takes its own course. We are now the young nation. Our demography is very powerful. By 2014, we'll have a 65% of our population which will be below 30 years of age, which is a fantastic, you know, achievement we'll have in a sense of our young generation, you know, will change this nation. I bank on this young generation, and all of you are very young. The nation is in your hand, and you have got to deliver. And that is the challenge before all of you. I can go on and on to tell you what we are going to become. You know, from 2000, 91, when the financial liberalization started, and in 2000, how our market cap grown, how our GDP has grown, and from $1.6 trillion of GDP today, I see by 2017-18 to become $4 to $5 trillion GDP. Will continue to grow at 7 to 8% per annum for the next 20 years. And in that, all young generation people, they will be ruling this country in next 15 to 20 years, because they will be more educated than our elders were. They have a great common sense, and they will think that what is the right for this nation. And therefore, I believe that the future of this country is in a safe hand. Why India is the place to be? In India, we have the largest number of companies which are listed on stock exchange, which is more than 5,000. Largest number of pharma plants, 61 approved by US FDA outside the USA. One of the world's largest exporters of cars. 9 out of every 10 diamonds sold in the world pass through India. One of the top 5 tourist destinations in the world and the fastest growing tourist economy. I have to give an example of tourism. You know, till about 3 years back, we had just about 6 million tourists coming into the country. And if you look at the country like Spain, 45 million tourists. Look at country like Singapore, such a small island, 10 million tourists. Place like Dubai, over 10 million tourists. I'm not comparing UK, London or Paris, where the tourist traffic is 65, 70 million people. I think this is the great opportunity for this country, because what do we have? We have sea beaches, we have Himalayas, we have forest, we have a history, and we have desert. What we don't have in this country? This country, if they develop their tourism, their economy will just start booming. And I think for that we need infrastructure, better facility of hotels, entertainment, and I think this is all possible to do it very quickly, and that will make the tourism, you know, a great boom for our GDP. We are the largest postal and railway system. We are one of the largest food producers in the world. Now this is very interesting statistics. 1/3 of Microsoft employees and 1/4 of IBM employees are Indians. Among the 6 countries that design, build and launch satellite, we are one of that, and we are the largest film industry in the world. All this is fine, but what are the concerns which our country have? We have a global concern, we have a US slowdown where the consumption is reducing, crisis in the Middle East and Africa because that is a source of oil. What will happen, who will control those places is very, very critical. Today, for example, Libya has got a $70 billion available to themselves, but there are no takers because all their accounts are freeze. And because of that, there are $70 billion, nobody wants to borrow money or take money from Libya. Look at Libya, Mr. Gaddafi is sitting on a gold, pure gold, of over 150 tons of gold, physical gold, lying in his possession. So the oil prices will become very critical for our nation. Also, impact of earthquake in Japan and tsunami, what will happen to that, whether that Japanese economy will recover or they will start spending more money. I think in the longer run, they will build better infrastructure, they will spend more money, and that will be very helpful. Domestic concerns and challenges are rampant corruption and political uncertainty highlighted by past incidents such as 2G scam, CWG in India. I think this is extremely frustrating, and we believe that, you know, if the politicians are just going to behave like this, I think the young generation will have to change them, because 65% of our population will be young. God, think about it, that how you change them, how do you vote in the next election, what you are going to do, and you know, I think that's very critical for the younger generation. Bridging the enormous deficit on the infrastructure side, we need much better infrastructure, you know, and that spending is substantially required. Other concern is rise in inflation and interest rates, because that will bring down the businesses, you know, growth rate, and that's why inflation has got to be under the control. And lastly, mass poverty, hunger and disease. So I think these are the issues before the nation, and we got to address it. We can't just run away from them, and it is important that we address this in a proper manner. It is said that nobody can go back and start a new beginning, but anyone can start today and make a new ending. So let's make a start. I think it's very important for all of you to make a start. You, as the manager of a next generation, India should imbibe competencies such as adaptive thinking, strategic insight, entrepreneurial drive, inclusive growth, and excellence in execution. You are the architect of your destiny. The world is yours to explore, and your life is only yours to shape. So make the right choices. On this note, I would like to once again congratulate all of you and wish you good luck for your future.